requirements for gathering in the name of Jesus. 6th September 2020, 23rd Sunday of the Ordinary Times. Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst, says Jesus in today's Gospel, Matthew 19, verses from 15. This statement is a very familiar statement of Jesus. We have many hymns based on this theme, but we need to reflect upon the meaning of gathering in the name of Jesus. What does it imply? And when we gather that way, He will be there, but what does that presence imply? There have to be some distinct qualities among the people who gather in His name. For instance, 1. There will have to be equality amidst them. If there were any type of discrimination against anyone in any manner, in terms of wealth, caste, social status, and so on, then Jesus will not be present there. So the first requirement is the sense of equality among those who gather in His name. Secondly, there needs to be a sense of unity among them. Unity is not a pragmatic need, which means that I give you what you need and you give me what I need. In that case, it's not actually unity, it's only a business deal. Unity is not just a social cohesion to make sure that we all need to live without conflicts. But unity is an essentially an existential need to make us realize that we cannot live without others. Therefore, if a child after its birth left alone, it cannot survive at all. The child cannot learn to walk or talk. Once we realize that we need others so essentially and existentially, then we will never do anything that harms the others because we know that we cannot live without them. Therefore, those who gather in the name of Jesus, there has to be unity amidst them. Thirdly, when we gather in the name of Jesus, there must be forgiveness. We will be ready to forgive others. That is what Jesus makes it clear in the Gospel passage today. If anyone sins against you, try to reconcile with him or her personally. If not, take with you one or two witnesses with you. But even then, he or she is not ready for reconciliation, take the matter to the elders in the church. And even then, if that effort fails, leave him or her alone. This again makes it clear that on our part, we must be reconciled, we must be ready for reconciliation, and we should not judge others. Again, Jesus demonstrates elsewhere, don't judge others and leave the judgment to God. This again invites us to have a clear understanding about judging. Any real judgment must be fair and impartial. But often our judgments are not so. In fact, all our judgments all the times are limited in some way or the other for two reasons. One, we will have something to gain personally from that judgment that we make. And secondly, we will not have the complete understanding about the situation at hand and the persons involved in that situation. Only God can have the complete understanding of both. Therefore, only God can give a perfect judgment. Further, so God is so perfect and complete that He does not need for Himself anything from that judgment. And that is why only God can give a perfect, complete judgment. Actually, in our judicial systems also we find there is always a provision for further appeal at higher courts, because the judge realizes that when the judgment is pronounced, it is based only upon the evidences that are available at hand at that moment. Perhaps in future, new evidences may come up and then the judgment can be corrected or even cancelled. And we have the possibility of appealing to the president for mercy. All these show that all our human judgments are essentially limited and confined only to the circumstances that are available at hand. Therefore, the requirement to gather in the name of Jesus is the sense of forgiveness and non-judgmental attitude. And finally, the fourth requirement is, when we gather in the name of Jesus, we will be ready to love others as we love ourselves. That's what today in the second reading, we find St. Paul reminding us again what Jesus has declared very clearly. All the laws and teachings can be summarized in this one commandment, that is, love others as you love yourself. In fact, this is known as the Golden Rule, said in different words in different religious and sacred traditions. But again, we need to have a clear understanding of the meaning of loving oneself. Self-love, is it not selfishness? Jesus is condemning selfishness and he invites us to go beyond ourselves to reach others. And he says we should love ourselves in Matthew 22:39, but other places he urges to deny oneself to follow him, Matthew 16:24, and again he says unless one dies to oneself one will not live, Matthew 10:39, and so on. So does it not sound as a contradiction? On the one hand he asks us to deny ourselves, on the other hand he asks us to love ourselves, and he is asking us to love others as we love ourselves, but we are supposed to deny ourselves. Does it mean that we should deny others also? So we need to have basic understanding and clarification with regard to the difference between self-love and selfishness. When I love myself, I will always be particular to see that my interests are taken care of and comfort and my comfort zones are not at all disturbed. I will not be bothered about others. But is it not selfishness? Still further, when and what I enjoy, even if something is really harmful to me, like smoking, use of alcohol or drugs or any other harmful practices, can I prescribe these things to others also? Because Jesus is asking me to love others as I love myself. If I love all these things, should I not give these things to others as well? Here we need to stop for a moment to clarify the meaning of loving oneself. Loving oneself is certainly being self-centered. Loving oneself is not being self-centered. When one is always focused only on one's interests, even at the cost of the well-being of others, when one does not care at all about others' suffering and misery, when one even unjustly appropriates what is due to others, all these things are expressions of selfishness. On the other hand, loving oneself is being genuinely interested in one's own holistic welfare. Now, what is this holistic welfare? This holistic welfare includes taking care of one's body, mind and soul. One must not be over anxious about one's own health, but one needs to take reasonable care of one's body. For instance, if one is consuming too much of salt and fat, then one is not loving one's heart. If one is not taking enough water every day, then one is not loving one's kidney. If one is not sleeping enough, then one is not loving one's brain, which results in many other bad effects like memory loss, irritability, lack of immune system, and so on. When I go on using my mobile, computer, laptop, or watching television in darkness, I am not caring for my eyes. In fact, my eyes are shedding tears, pleading me to take care of themselves. When we don't do enough physical exercises, our whole body suffers. When we don't expose ourselves to the sunlight enough, we lack in vitamin D. Our body is actually our life partner. This body of ours is with us from the time we are born, or even before that, till we die. So we are highly obliged to pay due attention to it by avoiding all that would be harmful to the physical health. So taking care of my body in its true sense is part of the holistic welfare. And similarly, in order to take care of my mind, I need to learn to be emotionally intelligent. One needs to learn to live without unnecessary stress and strain, which badly affects the hormonal balance in our body, leading to very many physical and mental problems. Further, one must take care not to lose hope and meaning in life, which would ensure the health of one's soul, which we can say the spiritual health. So, taking care of my body, taking care of my mind, and taking care of my spiritual health, that is soul, these things imply the total welfare of ourselves. All that we do, all that we undertake must ensure this total holistic health of myself, and that is self-love. Striving hard to preserve and promote one's total well-being is actually self-love, and to help others to obtain such three-dimensional total health, that is the real health of body, mind, and soul, to help others to obtain that total welfare is love for neighbors. Such holistic love for self leading to holistic love cannot be selfishness at all. Therefore, when we gather in the name of Jesus, and if we want to make Jesus present in our midst, we need to fulfill at least all these four requirements, ensuring equality, unity, forgiveness, and total well-being of ours and others. Let us think about it today. Thank you.